days like this.
Man. Thank you.
Oh, yeah.
Considering it was supposed to be torrential downpour today.
What's that?
Considering it was supposed to be torrential downpour today, I'll take this.
No, because I'm thinking. No, because I
come back here in Cincinnati.
More than 7,000 student athletes rising to become champions in 22 different sports at 13 esteemed institutions across 11 states. 360,000 students and 2.6 million alumni rise up in celebration of a Power Six conference known as the American, powered by determination.
Dominance for a fourth straight year.
Plato from 30.
Unbelievable.
And be able to celebrate this type of championship.
There's the record breaker. They are the champions of the American.
Starting lineups being introduced on what's turned into an absolutely gorgeous afternoon here in the Queen City. Let's head down downfield level. Third member of our broadcast crew, Richard Heide, for more on today's contest.
Hey, thanks, guys. You're absolutely right. It is a beautiful afternoon. It was a foggy morning here in Cincinnati, but the temperatures have really risen, and we're ready to play some tournament lacrosse, the inaugural in the American. We talked about it at the Open. Florida just has dominated this conference, 5-0 in conference play, number 10 in terms of RPI. But actually, believe it or not, although the Gators have won 8 games in a row, Vanderbilt has the better winning percentage, and that should be something to pay attention to. This team, number 41 in the RPI rankings, should be very interesting to see both of these two teams face off, despite Vanderbilt losing 18-9. Now, we mentioned it, Lindsey Rombeck, the top attack player in the American. She partners with Shannon Cavanaugh, 50% of the shots for the Gators, and 130 combined goals. But how about on the other side? Four players with 20 or more goals on the season. Sophie Furlong, Emily Mathewson, they lead the way for this attack team. And you look at this Vanderbilt team, they are fourth in the nation in assists per game. So this team can really distribute the shots and the goals. It should be an offensive firepower for both of these teams here this afternoon. Back to you guys.
Thanks, Richard. Yeah, no doubt we're looking at what will probably be a pretty offensive game. We've got a Vanderbilt side that shares the ball extremely well, but a Florida side that prides itself on its depth and their ability to score from lots of different spots.
Florida's been pretty sensational this year. You know, they've done extremely well on draw controls, 258 to 217. They're very effective with ground balls. Their shots per game is very good. They are a really good offensive team. They're stronger, they're quicker, and I think for Vanderbilt to win today, Brendan, their youngsters have to step up and maybe play the game of their lives, because there is such a difference. There's no question about it. Statistically, Vandy's put points on the board. The difference has been Florida's not afraid of playing the very best. They have a really, really difficult schedule. They played some of the top 10 teams in the country, and I think that's what Coach O'Leary wants from her Florida team. They want to be the best.
Well, one of the things I'm most interested to watch is the battle between Vanderbilt being one of the absolute premier teams in Division I lacrosse in causing turnovers against a Florida team that just doesn't make mistakes.
And on the flip side, the key will be for Vanderbilt to keep the ball hot. I know, Coach, you had talked about that. If they can find the next pass and perhaps give up the first shot available and get a better look, they'll have a chance. And, yeah, you got contrasting styles here coming to play, and everything's on the line. It's pretty much advance and survive in this tournament.
Well, let's touch base real quick on our key players in case our friends here watching may not have seen that in the Open. Of course, on the Vanderbilt side, they're pretty deep, but Julie Blaze is going to draw a lot of attention.
She will draw a lot of attention. She's been really good. And from her freshman year to now, Coach Hewitt says she's the hardest working player in the squad. And her preparation is great. And preparation is really key to winning championships.
There's no doubt about it. You can't fake being prepared when you're at this stage of the game. And if Vanderbilt wants to win a championship, they've got to make sure they take care of the little things, especially because on the Florida side, someone with the caliber and talent of Lindsey Ronbeck is an awfully big load to handle.
Well, she scored 90 points this year, 76 goals. And then with Ronbeck, another tremendous recruit who's turned into a fantastic player for Coach O'Lear and the Gators is Cindy Pareka. Pareka with 41 points on the year. She's awfully good. And what's really been good for Florida is their play and goal. Haley Hicklin has played extremely well this year, and she will be a key factor in this championship.
Well, the teams are coming out. Get a look at the young ladies from Vanderbilt. They'll be in the black tops with the gold trim and the white numbers and lettering. There's Julie Blaze, focused, determined, and hopeful that this is not her last game of the season. Of course, on the Florida side, yet again, they win the regular season conference championship in what is now their third different conference. Of course, this is the first year that the American has sponsored the sport. But they continue to play at a high level.
I'm curious too, Brendan, how Sophie Furlong will perform for Vanderbilt this afternoon, number 31. Coach says she looks like she's not trying to get open. She's cool, calm, completely selfless, and she has an amazing personality. It's good for a ball club to compete in that level.
Yeah, no kidding. No kidding. Madison Foglio will be in goal for Vanderbilt. You just saw her a moment ago as we get ready for the opening draw control. And it's won by the Gators. Off we go. The 2019 American Athletic Conference Championships and their first iteration here in Cincinnati. An early shot misses just a little wide, but Florida regains possession. That was Pareka right out of the chute. Let's give you the starting lineups first for Florida. Caroline Benitez, Sabrina Custodero, Lindsey Ronbeck, Grace Haas, Kara Trombetta, Shannon Cavanaugh, Brianna Harris, Caroline May, Maddie Hall, Caitlin Debkowski, of course Pareka, and then Haley Hicklin will be in goal as we had an early foul called.
And Shannon Cavanaugh, number 17 for Florida, wins the draw control to start it off. That is her 82nd draw control of the season.
So a free position from the left side. Florida tries to strike first. Sophomore from Baltimore, Grace Haas. Foglio gets ready. Shot wide right. Vanderbilt dodges an early bullet.
Foglio did a good job in goal, protecting the left side of the goal there, or her right side, forcing that shot away.
Foglio only making her second start of the season. That one went off the crossbar.
That was Lindsey Ronbeck cutting through, number 14. We talked about her effective scoring. Vandy, we talked about also, might want to switch up their defenses from man to zone. They've got great offense.
Well, you talked about a fast start for Florida. They haven't put it in the back of the cage, but they have dominated possession in a chaotic opening minute. Finally, one goes home for Pareka. Florida's on the board early. Sydney Pareka makes it 1-0.
Great sign for the Gators and Coach O'Leary's team. We talked about the fact that they've got to get off to a fast start. They were able to do it with draw control from Cavanaugh. Let's take a look at Ronbeck working around the net. Nice pass to Pareka. And a great job of driving it home on the left side for the first goal for the Gators this afternoon.
So much movement away from the ball by this Florida team as well. Just makes it awfully difficult. Before we get too far away from things, let's give you the starting lineups for Vanderbilt. Gabrielle Fornia has had a pretty solid season. She'll be in there at the outset. Sophie Furlong, Emily Mathewson, Gwyn Devon, Julie Blaze, Hadley Brown, Melanie Becker, Nikki Dedino, Melissa Hawkins, Hallie Reagan, and Alex Rasmussen, along with Madison Foglio.
Cavanaugh wins that second draw control. And Vanderbilt generally pretty good on the backside with Melissa Hawkins and Hallie Reagan this year. They're good friends, but that time with the goal, Florida attacking.
So the Gators right away trying to establish themselves early on. From the Sheekley Athletic Center in Cincinnati, a a facility that is, first of all, it's absolutely gorgeous, but it hasn't hosted a lot of lacrosse the last couple of years because of all the construction on campus. And so even though this is the official home of Cincinnati lacrosse, they've been playing about a couple hundred yards away over at Gettler Stadium. And a lot of that had to do with the renovations they were doing at the football stadium and at Fifth Third Arena. And now those are all complete. In fact, the last time that Cincinnati played here, they played Vanderbilt a couple of years ago. Commodores on their way up the field here. By the way, Jen Whalen, Chris Niblock, Joel Stein, and Kristen Demura are our four officials here in the first semifinal. Winner gets either Cincinnati or Temple Saturday at 1 o'clock for a championship. Ground ball picked up by Harris and then given right back the other direction. Good play by Blaze.
Vanderbilt has to be better clearing the ball. 8:32 in conference has to be good today.
Yeah, you really can't afford to have too many self-inflicted mistakes against a team that capitalizes with the efficiency that Florida does. And I think that's part of the reason why we talked about Vanderbilt needing to be efficient at the beginning of the telecast.
And you look at Vanderbilt being very careful right now on the offense, not trying to rush things, trying to get some good looks here.
A little bounced shot, didn't quite find the bottom of the net. Hicklin able to kick it away. And it's going back Florida's direction. Hicklin fired up.
You bet. Great job by Hicklin with her feet there. And to Vanderbilt's credit, they did get a good shot. Just not enough heat there in front of the goal.
Vanderbilt's a team that prides itself on its speed and athleticism, which unfortunately isn't necessarily going to be a decisive strength against a team who has those similar attributes in the Florida Gators. So you have to make sure that you do all the little things right. And Florida is also maybe a bit more possession-based, where Vanderbilt likes to run the field a little bit more often.
And they're attempting to do that right now. You can see when Rombach is cutting through, there's always two defenders taking a look at her. They're really well prepared. The Vanderbilt Commodores coming into this match, they know that Rombach can really hurt them with her scoring.
Mathewson and Furlong working in tandem on the offensive end. This is Hadley Brown, a young lady from Baltimore, Maryland. Far side, Bree Gross, just a freshman, but an important piece for Vanderbilt this year. Opening few minutes, Florida struck first. Sydney Pereca made it 1-0.
Mathewson, number 14, a very good offensive player. She usually draws the top defender.
Good chance for the Commodores, but didn't have enough of a window to shoot. Flag comes out. Looks like a foul's on Florida, so we'll have an 8-meter free position coming. And Vanderbilt will have an early chance to tie this up at one apiece.
We talked about Julie Blaze, strength, leadership.
Well, they're certainly relying on her early in the game here. Blaze cuts to the middle, shoots low, and scores. Vanderbilt ties things at one. Julie Blaze, an early goal.
She moved the keeper, Haley, away from the goal. A little bit of space here. Let's take a look at this. Goes to the left side. And the Doors tie this one.
21st goal of the season for Julie Blaze. That'll help Vanderbilt for sure. Again, I think when you consider what this game might give us, the reason why it's important for Vanderbilt to prioritize their efficiency is because they don't expect to dominate possession the way they have at a lot of times this year. And unfortunately for Vanderbilt, they kind of played themselves into this position because they knew they were going to be in the tournament when they played their last regular season game against Temple. But the way the schedule shook out, Temple and Vanderbilt were playing where the winner was going to be the 3 seed and the loser would be the 4 seed, just as Vanderbilt and Cincinnati played, the winner being the 1 and the loser being the 2, with this being the predetermined site. So the four teams kind of knew who was going to play each other, but the matchups were still to be determined going into the final game of the year. Foul called against the Florida Gators. That was Brianna Harris, the junior midfielder, that made the mistake. Florida's a team that's got a lot of championship experience, not just in their conference championships, but they've been to the NCAA tournament 8 times, including every single year since 2011. This isn't exactly a program that's been around for decades and decades. We're talking about a growing sport off the East Coast. It's made its way down into Gainesville. And I don't know if you can possibly give Mandy O'Leary enough credit for what she's done down there with Florida. Gators take the turnover. Look how fast they move up the field. Great couple of dekes and another goal. Lindsey Ronbeck, outstanding. 2-1 Gators.
That was the difference, was the deke that you mentioned. She froze the keeper. She moved to her left, fired on the inside half of the goal, and it's now 2-1 Florida.
And yet, don't forget about what Kara Trombetta did on the other end of the field to get it started.
Yeah, great defensive play by Trombetta from Florida, and the Gators have really notched it up offensively. 2-1.
Almost 6 minutes into the first half. How often you see this at the Division I level in particular, the teams that can not only play with speed but with accuracy, as Coach O'Leary looks on at her team, the fact that you're able to make two passes that essentially cover 45 or 50 yards, if you can do that consistently, you're going to beat the other team up the field time and time again.
There's no doubt about it. And at some point, conditioning comes into play here too. You make the other team work that much harder during the course of the game.
Well, the temperature here in Cincinnati is quite comfortable this afternoon. Although the way Shiekley Athletic Center is sitting down in this bowl, you might not feel the same level of wind that you would feel elsewhere in what is a fairly breezy city because of all the hills here in Cincinnati. You could definitely feel wind in certain parts of the city better than others. 73 degrees, mostly cloudy skies on the horizon, but overhead, it's partly cloudy.
Gators with another opportunity.
So we'll see if they can add a third goal here early in the game. Great save. Well done by Madison Foglio. Those high stick side saves, not always the toughest ones, but they can get your confidence going. Good high pressure from the Gators, and it forces a ground ball, but not yet a turnover. And with the whistle, officially a turnover.
Again, those are the kinds of things that Vanderbilt cannot afford early on in this match, to turn the ball over.
You know, Pereca, who has the ball on her stick here, such a talented player, and she's got such high lacrosse IQ. She doesn't necessarily need to be the facilitator on offense all the time, but she gets her teammates in the right spot, and I think that's where her value is even more impressive as Florida scores yet again. I mean, it was all Pereca setting up the offense, making sure they could run exactly the way they wanted to, and they strike for an early third goal.
No doubt about it. Great call, Brendan, because Pereca set up Carolyn Benitez with a great pass there. Let's take a look at this one. See number 3 cutting right in the middle of the defense, right over the top. Gators again, 3-1.
Coach O'Leary told us this week that she thinks the thing that most stands out about Pereca, as you get a look at Benitez, who scores that goal, Pereca elevates the game for the entire team with her ability to not just pump the team up, but to be a controlling, calming presence in chaotic situations. But she's an emotional player. For her to score early and then for her to facilitate a goal like that, Florida certainly looks like they're feeling good early on.
They are, and Vanderbilt's in the danger zone. They've got to be able to come up with some response here.
Well, so often this game is won and lost in the draw circle. And the team that controls draws often wins games.
Kavanaugh's done very well so far for Florida. She has not wanted, she has not lost a draw control at all.
Well, it's another turnover by the Commodores. They've been a little bit off kilter with that early on. 5 for 5. The draw controls have gone Florida's way. There's Pareca, as you can see, kind of calming things down. Near side, sweet shot, and another Gator goal.
Tried to isolate the left side, and unfortunately, Vanderbilt was not able to recover. That's Kavanaugh.
Kavanaugh makes it 4-1, 8.5 minutes in, and we've got a timeout on the field. How about this start by the Gators? Jumping all over Vanderbilt here in the first few minutes. And Beth Hewitt recognizing this opportunity to try to catch your breath and make sure they can mentally regroup. You don't want to let the game get away from you early on.
Not at all. That time, the cutter was Carolyn Benitez, and then they threw behind her, and Kavanaugh had a nice open opportunity there. And the Gators are executing extremely well early on in this match.
Well, your first key right out of the chute was fast start for Florida. Does this qualify?
This is it. The Gators have done exactly what the doctor ordered. They're in position, and that's all you ask for is your players to put yourself in a position to win the game.
Kind of tough for Vanderbilt coming into this against a Gator team that's just clicking on all cylinders. 5 for 5 on the draw control. They've scored 4 goals in the first 8.5 minutes. They really haven't had to make any offensive adjustments quite yet, but so far so good for the blue and orange. Obviously, for Vanderbilt, losing 2 games in a row to come into this with a loss here about a week and a half ago at Cincinnati, and then losing to Temple, they haven't really had the chance to be efficient yet because they haven't possessed the ball that often.
They haven't, and Florida's established a tempo, and they've got on the board quick. That's what they wanted to do. They're up 4-1. And Vanderbilt is in a hole. They got to find a way to turn things around right now.
So one of your keys there was senior leadership. If you're in this huddle right now and you're Beth Hewitt, what's your message to your upperclassmen?
Well, the focus has to be that Julie Blaze has to take over in some capacity. But then again, it's a team game. Everybody has to come together and everybody has to be connected. If not, this is going to be a long afternoon for Vanderbilt. The one thing that Coach Hewitt has to do, obviously, just be very positive. Continue to be positive. You can't be negative at all. You just have to be positive and continue to encourage and motivate and ask.
6 seniors on the Commodores roster, so it shouldn't all fall on one person's shoulders, but certainly Julie Blaze is among that group of upperclassmen. And we are ready for another draw control. 4-1 Florida in the opening 8+. All right, Vanderbilt able to finally settle in here. They can find a way to score on this possession. That'll help make that timeout feel like it was a little bit more effective, but first things first, they won the draw control.
Yep. Sometimes it comes in pairs, and hopefully for Vanderbilt, maybe that can be a starting point right now.
Vanderbilt got off to a great start this year, winning games right out of the chute and really kind of running away from teams. They won an exhibition game back way in early February, but their first 5 regular season games, they all found the win column. And then in their 10 regular season games after that, split them evenly 5-5, but losing 3 of their last 4, including an 18-9 loss down in Gainesville.
Speaking of that loss in Gainesville, and right now, Florida, as you look at the screen, is doing a very good job defensively man-to-man. They're not giving any ground whatsoever to Vanderbilt, and Vanderbilt's offense, we talked about the ball being hot, it's just not there right now.
Forney is trying to get free. Shot clock's inside 20. Forney had dumped it off into no man's land. And it's scooped up. Maddie Hall has it for Florida. And the Gators will clear this successfully and easily. Florida now 3 for 3 in their clear attempts. This is where the Gators can make you pay. Oftentimes they clear and quickly score as Pareca takes a shot too high. A couple players collide. Pareca, one of them banged up.
Now she hit her left forearm there. Hopefully she's okay and get some help there by teammate Grace House.
Hallie Reagan also just injured a little bit, but she seems to be okay. Ooh.
Took a nice hit there coming across there from Haley Reagan, one of the defenders for the Commodores.
All right, so Pereka and company get things settled in offensively. Here is Sydney to her left. Oh, somehow completely unmarked.
Wow.
Kavanaugh races to the net, fakes high and scores low.
Great job by Kavanaugh putting that ball down low on the ground. And again, you mentioned Pereka's ability to find the open gator, and it's 5-1. Again, Pereka, 44, good vision. Defense a little bit confused there for the Commodores as the Gators, Grace House, able to break them down.
You know, it's interesting. When you see Florida get set offensively, things look like they're slow, and then all of a sudden, it's been Pereka at the top, but it's as though she's just waiting. She picks her spot, and then everybody is full throttle, and it throws Vanderbilt into this chaotic state that they can't seem to recover from. Vandy takes an offensive draw control and brings it up the field. Good play by Cassidy Orban from West Morris Central High School in Long Valley, New Jersey. Well, Vanderbilt needs to find a way to stop the bleeding here. This is a good team. They've had a good season. They haven't played all that well at the end of the year because they played some tough competition. And obviously, you get to this point in the year, you're familiar with the other teams in your league. Sometimes you look at film from those old games, and sometimes you want to throw it out the window. Sometimes you want to learn from it. Where do you stand on that? Do you read too much into earlier matchups, or do you look at it, try to come up with the basics, and then just go out and play?
Sometimes you have to look at the earlier matchups to be able to identify what you need to do better. But if you're going to be good, just go out and play and adjust to the environment, because every environment's going to change. Officials are going to change. Field's going to change. Travel's going to affect your kids.
Souza really didn't want to go to her left hand here. Vanderbilt scrambling now, 13 to shoot. They get a chance right across the face of the goal. Mathewson couldn't put it home. And the Gators get it back. ...18 minutes left in the first half. American Athletic Conference semifinals. The Florida Gators and the Vanderbilt Commodores. If you joined us a little bit late, I'm Brendan Gulick alongside Mike Walensky, and we've got Richard Heide roaming the sidelines here in abundantly sunny, all of a sudden, Cincinnati. Commodores, after stubbing their toe that last offensive possession, quickly get the ball back. That'll help them a little bit.
Good job by Megan McGillis defensively, number 32 for Vanderbilt, creating that turnover. It looks like as much as they want to be efficient, they're a little bit afraid to shoot the trigger here.
And sometimes your defense has to be your best offense.
Mm-hmm.
You've got to rely on your defenders in games like this to try and take control, because there's a lot of inherent pressure on your offense when you're down by four to score your way back in it. But sometimes you got to have a defensive mindset of, hey, we want to give you more time on the possession. Let's go down to Richard on the sideline.
Hey, thanks, guys. New territory for both of these teams, obviously, in the inaugural American Athletic Conference Championship. But Beth Hewitt, in her first season as the head coach for the Commodores, came over from D2 Le Moyne College. And this team, as you talked about, got off to a great start this season. Their last tournament appearance for the Commodores came in 2010. So this team really seeking that berth into the NCAA tournament. On the other side, Florida is absolutely stacked, and you can see why. They have 11 shots and 5 goals already. 7 all-conference first-team selections for Florida this season. The best attack person, the best midfielder, and the best goalkeeper all come from the Gators. This team is firing on all cylinders at the point of attack, and you can see it.
Vanderbilt needs to turn it into goals. Approaching the midway point of this first half. They've been patient. It turns into a great look right in front of the cage. Took a little while, but finally Blaze tucks one in there. She's got two, and the Commodores get one back.
Patience finally pays off for Vanderbilt there as we take a look at the replay. They got Blaze cutting through, looking for that pass, and then turns, flips it through the five hole, and a goal.
That's a tough shot. Actually, I think it might have gone up to the upper left there. I thought it looked like Hicklin went low, expecting that low shot to go low, and faked her out up top. Either way, boy, a no-look goal, sneaking it over like that. My goodness. And Amanda O'Leary looking on and probably feeling like, defended pretty hard there, and sometimes you're going to give one up.
Yep, and she has to feel pretty good about her squad right now. And the beauty of this is for their team is, for all these teams, they have people on the bench who really do a great job of lifting their teammates up, whether they're winning or losing. That's part of successful teamwork.
Yeah, that's going to be a flag and a penalty.
And Sabrina Christadero, their number 10, rode right into Julie Blaze and knocked her to the turf.
Well, the last thing that they needed was to play down a player after surrendering a goal. So you see Christadero heading over, sophomore defender. And the Vanderbilt Commodores trying to make this one count. Good little deke on the far side. Flicked it back up top. Becker couldn't do anything, so Blaze got it back. The flag came out. Looks like maybe a foul on Trombetta. So we've got an 8-meter free position coming. Blaze already has a couple. Could she add another one? Oh, great pass across the middle. Instead of taking the shot, but it was mishandled. Vanderbilt still turns it into a good look. And they put one home. It's Sophie Furlong, 33rd of the year. Vanderbilt makes it 5-3 on a couple of goals.
And sometimes, as we talked about, it comes in pairs. That's how you're able to come back and make a run. And it's a good sign for Vanderbilt. They're doing a better job of moving around. There's a good cutter in the middle there. Furlong on the near post there, 5-3.
That was a terrific play, and frankly, when you have a one-player advantage, you have to be able to find those open teammates. If you get enough movement going on, sometimes that alone can create the open spaces. Furlong all smiles. She gets her first goal in the conference tournament. Team leader with 33 goals, although her 39th point is actually still second on the team behind Emily Mathewson, who's had a great year, 24 goals, 16 assists.
Orban there winning the draw control for the first time.
Here come the Commodores. First time all game we've seen Florida.
A little bit of rest.
Starting to be on their heels a little bit.
Yeah.
Where do you think they need a calming presence?
Well, as you mentioned, there were a person down, so that has an effect. The calming presence is creating a turnover. You create a turnover, you change momentum, and the energy really shifts to the Gators.
A little bit more pressure here on the defense and certainly on Haley Hicklin. Vanderbilt bunching things on the far side, getting ready to run the show. Good idea. Didn't work out the way they had hoped.
Mathewson's pass a little bit high for Orban, and this is where Florida It's a big piece for them to be able to get that turnover. Now they can settle back into the offensive end.
I mentioned Hicklin. She's a senior for the Gators and has played a lot of games. This is her 77th career game. More than 3,600 minutes in between the pipes as the shot clock resets. Florida Gators trying to get back to the NCAA tournament again. They've been there every year since 2011. And went through conference play yet again, undefeated this year. Bobbled pass. Harris couldn't hang on to it, and another turnover. And officially give Foglio the cause turnover. Here comes Gwynn Devon, one of the captains for the Commodores. Good stick work. Dumps it off and a good clearance.
Yeah, they haven't been able to clear the ball too well early on, and that was a good sign here. Now they can attack and score.
How about a quick goal? Boy, all of a sudden, this Vanderbilt team, who was down 5-1, has found some serious life, and they've come back within one goal.
Yeah, the doors are back in it. On the attack there, looks 19 is slipping through there for a nice look. And that's Maddie Souza with a fourth goal for the Doors this afternoon, and they're back in it.
Well, head coach Beth Hewitt, Richard mentioned that she's in her first year as the head coach, but she'd been an assistant on the staff the last several years, and she is such a believer in the well-rounded student athlete. She said, we want to win not just on the field, but in the classroom, and that is truly a priority for them. She said she wants to take this program and get them back in the national spotlight. She's not limiting herself to wanting to win a conference championship. She wants to win a national championship, and she hasn't shied away from that, but she recognizes that this is a good first step in trying to build that program, getting back to the conference tournament. And Vanderbilt is giving one of the better teams in the country in Florida a pretty good fight here in about 17 minutes into the game.
Alex Rasmussen really doing a good job defensively, number four in the black for the Commodores. Rombeck making her work.
Pereca. Oh, that was way too easy. Grace Haas puts it in. Pereca to Haas, totally unmarked. And she finishes for Florida.
Cassidy Orban, number nine, had a chance there to come across and mark her, but failed to do so. Got a nice look there, 6-4. Nice movement there. Bam on the right side.
It's a good shot by Haas, but I'm probably more concerned about the defense if I'm Vanderbilt in that particular setting than I am impressed by the goal by the freshman. You can't leave somebody totally unmarked like that with a free run at the cage.
There have been several instances early on where there's been some miscommunication on the back end by Vanderbilt that has allowed Florida to score. That's a big goal. They've earned the momentum around.
Gators have a 6-4 advantage on draw controls here. And they'll take their seventh.
Good effort by Kavanaugh.
Florida, 6 goals, 12 shots, 8 of them on goal. Nice defense. Several Commodores getting in there, but Blaze runs away with it.
A nice job by Haley Reagan on the defensive end for Coach Hewitt's club.
Fornia connecting with Souza. And the Commodores settled in. And they got off to a pretty rocky start, but they're known to be one of the better offensive units, not just in the conference, but in terms of output, they're one of the better teams in the country offensively. And I have to imagine that Mandy O'Leary is sitting there perhaps a little unnerved that this team got off to such a good start and maybe lost their edge a little bit.
Yeah, the edge certainly is off. And like you mentioned a minute ago, the word settled. I think Vanderbilt has finally settled in here.
Fornia trying to use her feet and her head to get around Trombetta, but passed it away. Bree Gross. Becker with a fake. Back to Gross. Shot clock still at 25. Plenty of time. Florida's been running this man-to-man defense all the way. 14 on the shot clock. Couple of fakes, drawing a double team. Thrown into traffic, and the Gators with a turnover.
Yeah, that's
well done.
Yeah, it's a tough place to put the ball, but the Gators came up big there.
Caroline May, outstanding effort. Well, now that we're far enough along in the game here, good 20 minutes in. I mean, Vanderbilt has done a pretty good job in terms of their efficiency. And I know that's something you wanted to touch on. 4 goals, 7 shots. And they've settled in certainly part of this game again. For more on that, let's head down to Richard Heide.
Certainly, you look at Vanderbilt storming back here. Just 7 shots in the game, but 4 goals on those 7 shots for Florida. The priority always has to be getting Lindsey Rhombeck on board. Second in the country in goals per game. Florida back on the board.
Well, Rhombeck's happy to let Grace House have her share. Another chance for House to go right through the middle. And with nobody in front of her, makes a great shot, puts it home.
That is the second, maybe the third time that House has been allowed to cut through in front of Gwen Devin, number 17. That just is a big play by the Gators.
Grace with her 32nd goal of the season. And the 18th ranked Florida Gators have a 7-4 lead.
Well, one of the things from the very beginning in the pregame warmups up to now, the Gators as a team on the sideline look really loose.
Oh, they do.
So that's a good sign for Coach O'Leary's club as they work through this first half.
Yeah, I have to imagine in some regard, the level of success they've consistently reached probably brings a little bit of pressure in and of itself, because from class to class, when you graduate as a senior and you look back, you say, hey, we've helped you establish a tradition, you've got to uphold it. Mm-hmm. And you probably feel that a little bit as an underclassman when you've won the conference in the regular season and gone to the NCAA tournament so many years in a row. It becomes a disappointment if you don't get back there. And so the expectation's there, the work ethic is there, but you've got to go out and execute. I'd still rather be on that side of the equation than trying to do it for the first time.
Yeah.
Good defense by the Commodores. And a foul on.
Yeah, look like
Julie Blaze. Yeah,
Julie Blaze got her stick up a little bit too high into Kavanaugh's nose.
She gets a yellow card. And Vanderbilt will be down a player.
Right there.
Ooh. Ouch. Oof. Kavanaugh's a tough kid, but that looks like it hurt. Of course, the Gators with a roster that consists largely of young women from New York, New Jersey, Maryland, all hotbeds for lacrosse. Of course, Florida competes in the American. Oh, great shot. Sydney Pareka, sweet goal. Florida leads this one 8-4.
Excellent job by Pareka, cutting through. Took 2 steps and fired home. Not a lot of time to react to that one.
Sydney Pareka, who's had just a remarkable career so far, has a lot of lacrosse in her future. No doubt about that. After recently being drafted, she and Rhombeck both drafted just a couple weeks ago. Vanderbilt did all that work down 5-1 to get it back to 5-4. And all of a sudden now they trail 8-4. 9:28 and counting here in the first half.
The difference here is that Florida has really done a great job getting the ball up quickly up the field. And that's what Coach O'Leary wanted to do.
He's actually getting ready right as Pareka scored there to make the comment that, of course, Florida competes in the SEC and so many sports, as does Vanderbilt, but both are affiliate members of the American in women's lacrosse. It's great to have the inaugural championships held this year, and I'm imagining that the UConn Huskies and the ECU Pirates paying attention and trying to figure out what they need to do to get a little bit better next year to try to be on this stage.
One of the things that impresses me about Florida is their strength. And I know that they have a trainer that travels with them, but you can just tell their kids are physically fit.
You know, both these schools take a lot of pride in trying to make sure that this late in the year, when nobody's really playing at 100%, I mean, everybody's got bumps and bruises and you might be a little bit worn out, but that's what all the off-season training is for. You try to make sure that your body is still able to hold up when it comes time to try and compete for championships. Forney is in trouble. Gave it away.
Impressive defense by Caitlin Dobkowski, number 33 for Florida.
And a sloppy turnover right away.
There's a foul.
I'm going to have a free position here in just a moment. It's the first time in quite a while that Florida has flinched a little bit under pressure.
Just a tad. But again, it's aggressive play that's caused that. So take a look at Sophie Furlong going down on the field, being knocked to the turf.
Boy, that's tough defense.
That's really good.
Just not letting Melanie Becker get free at all.
Krista Derrido, number 10 for the Gators. Solid on the back end for Florida today so far.
Becker, second team all-conference this year. Of course, Florida swept the major awards. Ron Beck, attacker of the year. Shannon Cavanaugh was midfielder of the year. Trombetta, defensive player of the year. And Hicklin was the goalkeeper of the year. Good shot. Hicklin with a great save. Shot was up top from Blaze, who's had a good first half. Vanderbilt's consistently going at it. And this time, Florida picks up a yellow card.
And Coach, you had talked about the fact that for the Doors to be successful, they need to make the ball hot moving around. They weren't able to do that early on. And I think right now they have found a place, and they're starting to move the ball and break down that Florida defense. And they, as a result, now they have a shot at adding number 5.
Caitlin Dabkowski, she's the culprit. Young lady from Cockeysville, Maryland. Went to Delaney High. About 7 minutes left in the first half. Florida has an 8-4 lead. They've never trailed. The game was tied at 1. And they took a 5-1 lead and led 5-4 and now lead 8-4. The good news for Vanderbilt, so they've kept it tight. And if you can keep winning draw controls, all of a sudden a 4-goal game can really swing back in a hurry.
Haley Hicklin again comes up big in goal.
Well, look at Pereka. Coach O'Leary talked about her speed being one of her best attributes. You saw it on display right there. Just flat out by herself successfully clears it. There it is again from Sydney, that calming presence. A reset of the shot clock here. I'm not sure why. They're going to give it back the other direction. Andy O'Leary wants to know why and then quickly says, well, let's apply some pressure defensively. Can't dwell on things that don't go your way. Matchup between the top seed and the 4 seed. The winner here plays for a conference championship Saturday afternoon against the winner of Cincinnati and Temple. That game coming up approximately 45 minutes after this first game concludes.
players can make mistakes and you can make turnovers. What you look for is how you respond to them.
Absolutely.
You dwell on it or you just move on. And if you can move on and five players like that are just focused, minute by minute, play in the moment, you've got a chance for a championship caliber athlete.
Pereca holds the ball, looks around a little bit. Let's talk about killing time. Vanderbilt says, hey, enough's enough. Seconds on the shot clock. The Gators content to use as much of that time as they can. Pereca makes a good pass. Thrown back her way. They quickly work near side and a foul.
Coach Hewitt again switching defenses there out of the zone. Florida with another opportunity upcoming.
Kavanaugh's already had a good game. Two goals to her credit already. Make it a third.
Wow.
Shannon Kavanaugh rifles her 57th goal of the year into the back of the net. And the Florida Gators lead it 9-4.
Tremendous job by Kavanaugh as you take a look at it. Three steps to the right. Nine to four.
She got such a quick shot that I think she basically just looked at it and said, well, if you're going to hold your stick over your right shoulder, I'll shoot it over your left. It's obviously a tougher angle when you're shooting from that side and looking far post. But just kind of drop the stick down to the right, the quick release. That's that. So the Gators, thanks to a first half hat trick from Shannon Kavanaugh, they've scored 9 goals on 15 shots, and 11 of those 15 have been on goal, so only 2 saves for Vanderbilt's Foglio. Wow. Apparently Vanderbilt gets credit for a goal. Have to admit, I didn't see that.
I missed that too. Orban won the draw control. Then Orban had the shot there. Let's take a look at this one. Well, I don't know. It looked like it hit the post.
I thought that was pretty solid iron.
Yep.
Especially with the direction with which the ball ricocheted out. I think Mandy O'Leary's got legitimate beef there. We just saw a great look on the instant replay. All right, well, hey.
Way it goes.
Take them any way you can get them, and sometimes you need a fortunate break or two. Get another good look at this here. Watch the top left side of the goal.
I don't think so.
You know, on second look, it deflected off of Hicklin's stick and went in an upward direction, but I still don't think it crossed the line. Either way,
I don't think so.
Vanderbilt catches a break.
And there's no replace, so move on. Look at Florida. Wow.
They gave it right to Lindsey Ronbeck. And a yellow card coming. It's on Devin. .415 left in this first half. And right after Vanderbilt was able to grab a goal. The old saying, ball don't lie. Well, Florida immediately gets possession back after winning the draw control. Now they've got a one-player advantage and a chance to avenge that mistake. And right away, Vanderbilt comes away with a turnover. Let's see if Florida goes into a ride here. Final couple minutes of the first half. Here come the Commodores.
Number 20, Lexi Smith for the Commodores. They've got to find a way to convert here.
Well, right now the difference in this game has been Florida's start, because ever since they had a 5-1 lead, we've played to a 4-4 tie. Gators trying to clear up the near side. Maddie Hall successfully does so.
Maddie Hall kickstarted it defensively for Florida, and now with Pereca in command.
So we're inside 3 minutes to go in the first half. Top seed Florida Gators have not lost since March 19th when they fell to Princeton. At the time, the ninth ranked team in the country. Florida's got a free position coming. Gators' losses this year at the time of those games played were frequently to top 10 teams in the nation. We'll go over that in just a second. Another chance and another Shannon Cavanaugh goal. Four of them in the first half. All Gators here in Cincinnati.
Tried to give her a different look than last time, but Cavanaugh aggressively moving towards the goals. You take a look at this one. Good strength. Bam.
You know what I love about Cavanaugh is the mix between her grace and her power. When she's on that 8-meter line and she explodes forward, she's got a different kind of mentality and power to her. She's laughing about it now, but she's a fierce player. And yet her ability to be agile and stop and cut the way she does there and still protects the ball. She's very, very athletic. Started to say right before the free position that Florida's losses have come to some really tough teams. Losing to Princeton, North Carolina, Syracuse, Loyola, Navy, and Maryland. They were ranked 9, 3, 4, 17, 9, and 2 in the country when they played against those teams.
Again, you want to be the best, you have to play right. The best. Don't worry about your win-loss record. Worry about how it develops your team from start to finish. And the way Florida's playing right now, they're finishing really strong.
Well, they've got possession approaching the two-minute mark here late in the first half. Shot clock's at 60 with a game clock just over 2 minutes. Pereca doesn't care what time's on the clock, and she runs into a brick wall. My goodness.
Got hammered there by Gwen Devon, number 17.
You talk about strength and conditioning. Pereca doesn't miss many days in the weight room. She is
like
a tough kid. And it kind of stands out. I mean, she's got pipes, man. She's cut unlike most other players on the field. And in moments like this, it's paying off for her. Shoots and scores.
Tremendous speed. Right out of the gate there, Pereca with a big, big goal there.
Well, we talked about needing to have some leadership when things get rocky. And when they gave up three goals, Sydney Pereca said, okay, we'll put this on my back. And she has been dynamite here in this first half. As Hicklin comes all the way up the field just to say, hey, thanks.
You gotta like too her competitiveness, her focus. After she scored, she's right back talking to her teammate Romblin and trying to figure out what the next step is as they have taken control of this one at 11-5.
Looks like we've got a goalie change coming for the Vanderbilt Commodores. It's been kind of a tough go for Foglio, so you might as well try and see if somebody else can give you a different result. Time for Grace Bell, senior from Poly Prep in Brooklyn, New York. Commodores down by a half dozen late in the first half. Florida has scored 11 goals on 13 shots on goal.
Pretty much right on schedule for Florida. They averaged over 34 shots a game this year. I think from the very beginning, they've been able to dictate tempo in this match.
Let me ask you this. If you're one of Cincinnati or Temple's coaches watching this game, what stands out to you most about the way Florida's executed?
They're playing really, really hard. They don't slow down. And they're in great condition. And they have, as I said before, they've established a tempo. So some way, somehow, obviously it looks like Florida has a chance here to move on. You've got to be able to slow them down some way. That's a very difficult task. They have superior athletes and certainly great coaching.
Vanderbilt almost desperate for a goal here late in the first half. Down by six. And the Florida foul. Florida Gators have scored six of the last seven goals in this game. Wow. Some high contact there. Holy smokes.
Yes.
Thankfully, Bree Gross appears to be all right, but she certainly took a high shot. You might want to shield your eyes watching this.
That was Trombetta, number 16, just kind of clipped her. Good aggressive play by Vanderbilt.
It's just less than a minute. Shot clock at this point is irrelevant. And a free position for the Commodores. Instead of trying to shoot right away, they went for a pass and shot. But Emily Mathewson, the junior attacker, crossed over the line inside the goalie circle.
They've tried to do that twice today, and both times they have not been executing it, but it got a turnover.
Beautiful takeaway back, but Hicklin comes up big with a save. Holy cow. You want to talk about Haley Hicklin stepping into the limelight. Throws it away and then immediately locks back in. It's a great interception.
Mm-hmm.
That's a player taking pride in saying, you know, I made a mistake, but not going to let my team down. About 20 seconds left in regulation. Approaching halftime, where the top-seeded Florida Gators, who beat Vanderbilt 18-9 back on April the 6th, trying to add another one. 5 seconds to go. A quick late shot and a goal.
Wow.
Lindsay Ronbeck, with less than a second on the shot, puts it home. 0.3 remaining. Florida 12, Vanderbilt 5.
Well, the good news for the Gators, they were attacking towards the end zone where the scoreboard is, and I'm certain that the players had the scoreboard in full view, and Pareka knew that she had to shoot it really, really fast. That is huge for the Gators.
Just for confirmation, the clock that you see in the top corner is not official. It's moving at the same pace as the clock here in the stadium, but that is not the official clock, so where that may have flashed before the shot could have gone in, the stadium clock says 0.3, so the goal does count. That's a really tough break for Vanderbilt. Mm-mm-mm. What a first half by Florida. Scored early, took the lead, and they haven't looked back. 12-5 Gators, and Mandy O'Leary's team is 30 minutes away from punching her ticket to an American Athletic Conference championship game appearance. We'll stop down on the field in just a moment to check in with Coach O'Leary. But, Mike, your thoughts on the first half?
Great effort by Florida right off the bat. They did exactly what they needed to do. They played the ball hot offensively, defensively, really good. Hicklin was fantastic in goal. It's the reason why they won eight in a row.
Let's go down to Richard.
Thanks, guys. I'm here with the head coach, Mandy O'Leary, for the Florida Gators. Coach, you came in. What was your game plan and the plan of attack coming in? What challenges did Vanderbilt present?
I mean, Vanderbilt is a great team. We knew that going in. They have a great coaching staff, so we knew they were going to be well prepared. So our goal was just to step out on the field and play Florida lacrosse. We needed to step out, play good offense, and, you know, put the ball in the back of the net. And defensively, we, you know, need to come up with some big saves, and Haley did that. And I thought our defense is playing pretty solid right now.
Cindy Pareca offensively, not just the facilitator, but also a goal scorer in that first half. How would you judge her performance?
Oh, fantastic. I mean, we want the ball in Sydney's stick, and she is facilitating some great plays out there. So we're excited with what she's doing right now and hope we can continue in the second half.
Coach, you've made 8 NCAA tournaments, and you've also won 6 conference titles. How much confidence does that give you as a coach, and also what you can do to get your players going as well?
You know, I think each year is very different, so, you know, that's great. But this is a whole new team, and, you know, we need to make it this year. So we need to prepare for this year, not looking back at what we did in years past.
Well, great start. Thanks so much for your time.
How about that first half by Pareca? 3 goals, 5 assists. Kavanaugh with 4 goals as well. A dominating first half by the Florida Gators. They lead 12-5 at the intermission over the Vanderbilt Commodores, the top seed, holding steady so far. We'll come back with some halftime stats and analysis on the other side of this timeout here on the American Digital Network.
More than 7,000 student athletes rising to become champions in 22 different sports at 13 esteemed institutions across 11 states. 360,000 students and 2.6 million alumni rise up in celebration of a Power 6 conference known as the American, powered by determination.
Strong in mind, strong in body, strong in school, sport, life.
The grind is 10% physical and 90% mental.
The mind is the power.
The body is a means to jump higher, run faster,
be smarter, and live longer.
There is no weakness when it comes to seeking help.
We are stronger together.
So let's talk about it.
A waterfall starts with one drop.
Change starts with one person.
The American is dedicated to ending the stigma related to mental health
and promoting success through a healthy, powerful mind.
Promoting success through a healthy, powerful mind.
Purdy scores!
3 strikeouts in a row.
Dominance for a 4th straight year.
Queso from 30!
Unbelievable!
And be able to celebrate this type of championship.
There's the record breaker! They are the champions of the American.
Power comes in all forms.
Power is a big tackle,
a big save, a clutch hit,
or a game-winning shot.
Power is also standing up for what is right.
There is power in the sportsmanship that is displayed across the American.
Power is respecting opponents,
officials,
student athletes,
coaches, and team representatives.
Power is not tolerating racial or ethnic comments,
profanities, or other improper actions while at the game.
The American.
Power for life.
The American. Power for life.
The American. Power for life.
How do you drive impact for 200 years? By doing it boldly, by building a bridge, breaking a barrier, planting a flag, owning a stage. Because here, we learn by doing and believe the status quo was built to be broken. So be proud, be bold, be Cincinnati. We're 2 centuries in, and we're still creating what's next. We are Boldly Bearcat.
Halftime in Cincinnati, where the Florida Gators have a 12-5 lead over the Vanderbilt Commodores in the AAC semifinals Top seed and unbeaten team in the league, looking really good. They've got 8 points from Pereca, 4 goals from Kavanaugh early. Florida holding strong. We'll come back in just a minute.
More than 7,000 student athletes rising to become champions in 22 different sports at 13 esteemed institutions across 11 states. 360,000 students and 2.6 million alumni rise up in celebration of a Power Six conference known as the American, powered by determination.
Strong in mind, strong in body, strong in school, sport, life.
The grind is 10% physical and 90% mental.
The mind is the power.
The body is a means to jump higher, run faster,
be smarter, and live longer.
There is no weakness when it comes to seeking help.
We are stronger together.
So let's talk about it.
A waterfall starts with one drop.
Change starts with one person.
The American is dedicated to ending the stigma related to mental health
and promoting success through a healthy, powerful mind.
Promoting success through a healthy, powerful mind.
Bernie scores!
3 strikeouts in a row.
Dominance for a 4th straight year.
Queso from 30!
Unbelievable!
And be able to celebrate the 7th championship.
There's the record breaker! They are the champions of the American.
Power comes in all forms.
Power is a big tackle,
a big save, a clutch hit,
or a game-winning shot.
Power is also standing up for what is right.
There is power in the sportsmanship that is displayed across the American.
Power is respecting opponents,
officials,
student athletes,
coaches, and team representatives.
Power is not tolerating racial or ethnic comments, profanities, or other improper actions while at the game.
The American.
Power for life.
The American. Power for life.
The American. Power for life.
Top seed Florida Gators looking good. 12 goals in the first half. They've only been stopped twice in terms of their shots on goal. Vanderbilt trying to come up with a winning formula, and they need to do it quickly as we look at some of the first half highlights. These highlights are going to frequently feature lots of Florida success, Mike.
Yeah, Florida's been really dominant offensively here this afternoon, and Rombeck got them off to a great start there along with Kavanaugh.
Rombeck, 2 goals, 1 assist in the first half. Sydney Pereca, 3 goals, 5 assists, and she seems to be involved on every single play. And, of course, Kavanaugh, 4 goals as well. Great goaltending, though, has taken some of the spotlight. Haley Hicklin looks good.
Oh, she's been fantastic today. And with that, as a team that's first in the conference and 5th in the nation in fewest turnovers, so if you got great goalkeeping, you can play efficiently, you got a chance to really be on top.
The teams have just come back out of the locker room as the Vanderbilt Commodores are trying to find a way not only to get stops defensively, but on the offensive end, figure it out. Okay, let's go down to the field with Richard Heide and Coach Beth Hewitt.
Hey, thanks, guys. I'm with the head coach for Vanderbilt, Beth Hewitt. Very tough first half stopping this team. Sydney Pereca, Beth Kavanaugh, they're such tough players. How do you stop them and neutralize them defensively?
Yeah, we just got to play a little bit better team defense and try to help each other out. And, you know, right now we're kind of letting them run through the middle of us, and obviously that's not our game plan. So trying to get in position, get that slide to be there, and see if we can slow them up a little through their fast break.
Coming into this game, you guys were 4th in the country in assists per game. You really facilitated the ball well all season long. How do you get back to that offensively?
We just got to keep it a little bit more hot. I think right now we're kind of holding on to it a little bit too long and trying to be too much of an individual game, and that's really not how we play our best lacrosse.
First season as the head coach, what are you learning throughout this process?
We got to keep playing. We got to be resilient.
Thanks so much, Coach. Coach Beth Hewitt for Vanderbilt. Back to you guys.
I'm going to take a look at the bracket. The winner of this game will play either Cincinnati or Temple on Saturday. And while certainly Vanderbilt would like to be in that championship game, they've got their work cut out for them. What do you see that they need to make a big adjustment on?
Well, just like Coach Hewitt had talked about, they need to make the ball more hot. They need to share the ball more and be more active. And then defensively, somehow they got to find a way to communicate, because there have been some breakdowns in the backside that have allowed the Gators to have a nice couple of looks and a few goals there. But from the standpoint of Coach Hewitt being in her first year, I'm really impressed by her, and I'm impressed by all these head coaches in this tournament. They're extremely articulate. They're extremely focused on what they want to accomplish, and they're very positive. And that's all you want from a student athlete who wants to compete at the next level.
Yeah, you want a coach that you know you can rely on, both when you're on the field and in the classroom, but someone that's going to give you the guidance and direction and yet the flexibility to develop as a person, right? By the way, you can follow us on Twitter. You get a chance to see our conference-wide Twitter account. We'll have plenty of highlights and conference information along the way. So certainly check that out, some of the highlights from the first half. I'm pretty sure they're cutting those back at headquarters. Getting ready for the start of the second half. And the Florida Gators, who've had a pretty good run at the draw control circle early on. It's Vanderbilt who commits a foul, and Florida's off and rolling here in the second half.
Draw controls are huge, and Florida's done great. Kavanaugh's been really good, and Orban just hasn't been able to compete as well as Kavanaugh. And that's been also a reason why Florida's been able to get the ball and really move it up the field quickly. They've done a great job clearing it this afternoon.
Yeah, lots of great first half highlights available on some of those impressive goals on Twitter. So you can find those on social media if you're just catching up on all that's gone on so far here this afternoon.
And here's an interesting, too, with Florida up 12-5, as you see, they can slow it down now. They don't have to have a concern about the clock at all, and they can be more efficient. As I talked about, they're a team that doesn't turn it over much, and they have been really shooting the ball well today.
Well, I agree they have the ability to be meticulous on this group of offensive possessions right away out of the gate. But I think they're also cognizant of trying to get that 10-goal lead, and then Vanderbilt has to play against the Gators and the clock. Pereca takes it herself and scores.
Wow. That is just a tremendous shot. Pereca and Kavanaugh both and Rombeck have unleashed some fireballs there, and it's very difficult for the goalkeepers this afternoon for Vanderbilt to compete against. Great job by Pereca finding a hole there and firing on the left side, well past the goaltender's reach, their number 18. The youngster, Grace Bell, checked in the lineup midway through the first period.
You want to talk about a young lady that's playing with her hair on fire. Sydney Pereca's had a career day. That is her fourth goal to go along with 5 assists. 9 points is a new single-game career high for Sydney Pereca, the senior from Mount Sinai, New York. On the season prior to today, she had a 5-point game against Vanderbilt back on April 6th and is coming off a 6-point game against Cincinnati, playing some of her best lacrosse this year toward the end of the season, but she has never had 9 points in a game. By the way, her career high in goals is 6. The 5 assists is already a single game career high. So really one of the best games that Pereca's ever played, and that's saying something for someone who's accomplished all that she has.
Yeah, and what's amazing about this too, if you look at her, she's only 5'2", and she's a fireball.
That's such a great point. You never look at her and think that she's going to be one of the shorter players in the field because she's so aggressive.
She looks like about a foot taller than she really is.
Not afraid of the contact, no doubt about that. All right, so Vanderbilt immediately absorbs a blow, and now they've got to try to dial it in.
And early on, it looks like they're doing a better job moving the ball around.
Nice job, Bree Gross. Vanderbilt gets one back. It's 13-6.
It's nice to see the Commodores come back and attack there. Bree Gross this year has 40 draw wins, but for the most part, it looks like Orban who's been the person that's been taking the draws mostly for the Doors this afternoon.
Well, if you're Vanderbilt, you kind of have to know that it's tough to stop Florida, but if you can dominate possessions and control the second half, that's the best way you can try to get back in the game.
Don't have to worry about the clock at this point in time. Just focus on what's in front of you and compete.
A couple minutes into the second half. From all of a sudden, cloudy Cincinnati, Ohio. They are expecting rain this evening around 9 o'clock, so we're still a good ways away from that. It rained hard this afternoon around 2 o'clock, 1:30. But the rest of the afternoon had clear skies in the forecast. So we might see some rain perhaps in the second game of the night, but not anticipating that here in the second half of game one. Commodores. Left side bounce shot didn't quite go home. Good effort from Souza, but Vanderbilt keeps it. Good look inside, better save by Hicklin.
And Vanderbilt doing a much better job moving the ball around, making it hot, as Coach Hugh had mentioned. Makes it more difficult for the defense and puts them on edge.
Shot clock was at 30, finally a foul on the Gators. Well, the officials are being waved over to the far side. I think there might be a shot clock malfunction.
Still plenty of time for the Commodores to get back into this match with the Gators.
And while I agree with that, they just don't have any time to waste.
No,
you got to make sure you're locked in. By the way, on the far side, just beyond the confines of the stadium, the East Carolina University bus just rolled by. I would imagine that's probably their eighth nationally ranked baseball team who is in town to play the Bearcats this weekend. They've got games tomorrow. Of course, the Pirates fell a little short of qualifying for the Women's Lacrosse Conference Championship Tournament.
Florida's still in that man defense.
All the way down, they had to let it go. And with the horn blowing, you can hear shot clock expires and a turnover.
I mentioned Caroline May did a very nice job defensively for Florida. They're still really working like crazy on the defensive end. And again, Haley Hicklin has done tremendous in goal today for the Gators. So she's done as she's done for most of the season.
So the Gators up by 7. That's the margin they had at halftime, each team with an early second half goal. Vanderbilt hasn't done too well in games where they haven't scored a lot this year. They've been such a offensive-minded team. But in the games where they've been held at bay, typically they haven't come out on top. The exception was an overtime win at Louisville, 9-8. But other than that, when they've been held below 10 goals, they have not come out on top. Lost to Notre Dame 18-6, lost to Florida 18-9, and dropped a game to Temple 11-6.
Good job by Bell, knocking away on Grace's house's opportunity.
And yet all of those previous games, while they're kind of in the back of your head, can't do anything about it. You just have to focus on what's in front of you here. Still a tendency nonetheless.
I've always enjoyed programs who schedule up and want to compete against the best, because you know that those coaches want the very best from their kids, and it's not a matter of one loss during the regular season.
Superb defensive effort by Caroline May. Anticipation from a long way away. Comes up with the turnover. Florida Gators, one of the hottest teams in the country. They have not lost since March 19th. 11-6 on the campaign. They went undefeated in AAC play, and also had wins against Jacksonville, Brown, and Stony Brook, 9 in a row. Boy. They had another goal, and right now have Vanderbilt in a really tough spot.
Tremendous job by Pareka once again in delivering an assist there to Grace House. That's a nice goal. Again, Florida doing a great job of everybody moving and sharing the ball, making it hot and making it really difficult for Vanderbilt today.
Meanwhile, Madison Foglio is back in goal after being pulled late in the first half. Foglio has seen a lot of time this year, but not all of the time in goal. Of course, Lily Argyle, 15 games played. And I think they kind of miss her right now. I believe it's a coach's decision that she's not in. I don't believe that she's dealing with an injury. We were anticipating that Argyle would be the starting goalkeeper. All right, here come the Gators. 14-6.
Maddie Hall, number 23. She's had a nice outing today.
Lost the ball there because she was illegally interfered with. Hall, one of the seniors for Florida. They restarts.
It's interesting, Brendan, from the standpoint of only one Gators from Florida out of Orlando.
Right.
But that could change. I think Lacrosse is really starting to, you know, kind of create some momentum at the high school level. So we might see more kids out of Florida eventually join this roster. What a play.
Wow. 15-6 Gators. Another Florida goal for Grace Haas.
Great effort there by the Gators, 15-6. And there's not enough time left for Vanderbilt. Even though there's 23:42 left, they are really going to have to pour it on here to get back into this one. Down by 9.
You know, Mandy O'Leary made a great point to us earlier in the week, and it's something I just noticed here as I watched the Florida bench celebrating after that goal. She says, our bench may not get a lot of playing time, but they are so enthusiastic. And they really stay behind the group, both during positive plays and during frustrating times. She says, our bench doesn't get the credit they deserve for why we've had a successful season. And the Gators are on the doorstep of qualifying for the conference championship game on Saturday. And those young ladies have been pretty dialed in tonight.
No doubt. They've been sharing the ball very well. And defensively, they've really been on it. They made life really difficult today for the Vanderbilt Commodores.
One more Florida goal would put the running clock into effect and would make things awfully tough for the Commodores. Florida causes another turnover. Kavanaugh attacking up that left side. She's really developed a great ability to shoot with her left, even though she's a natural right-handed shooter. Pareka, I'd say she runs the show, but right now she's not running anything, just kind of waiting around.
Yeah. They're working that shot clock down to 60. No rush.
Yeah, no pressure from Vanderbilt either.
Mm-mm.
Pareka dumps it over to the right side. And a foul. Ronbeck's got a free position. Florida trying to put the stranglehold on the Commodores. C 16-6.
Great play.
Rombeck strikes again.
Rombeck comes across and really forces Foglio, the goalkeeper, to be confused. And then fires it on the far corner for number 16. Take a look at this one. Nice. Bounce it in on one hop.
I don't want to speculate at the nature of that conversation, but given that we're at this time of the game here and there's now a running clock in effect, perhaps it was about the current situation. The clock stops here, 21-22, with a timeout called for by Vanderbilt. Well, if you're the Commodores, you need to come up with a goal in a hurry.
Really fast. They've got to get one right now. Otherwise, this one has completely slipped away. And then, frankly, on the defensive side, you have to attack. You can't let Florida just sit back and work the clock down, which they've been able to do. They haven't even looked to start moving the ball around until under the 60-second mark, and that's about 30 seconds that runs off the clock. And it just makes each possession more and more difficult. When Florida's as efficient as they are, it's a recipe for disaster for Vanderbilt.
I think that's where some of the frustration has been. Vanderbilt has kind of sat on their heels defensively, and for whatever reason, they've kind of let Florida dictate things. In the meantime, we're going to get down on our field side, and we'll join Richard Heide, who's down closer to the action. Richard?
Very interesting to see the onslaught here for Florida. They have really poured it on. This is a team that averages 15.5 goals per game, but Vanderbilt on the other side averages 14.5. Right now, just 6. I think one other interesting aspect of both of these teams is the different splits when you look at home and away. At home, Vanderbilt 6-1, 4-4 on the road. On the other side, you look at Florida, they are 7-2 in road games. So maybe that's why they are very comfortable here at the University of Cincinnati, even when it's outside of their home arena. Back to you guys.
Well, there's no doubt this Florida team has played well at home and on the road, and maybe more importantly, they've just played well lately wherever they've gone out. And they've got Vanderbilt in a pretty uncomfortable spot right now.
Do, and I tell you what, I suspect that based on our conversation off the air a couple days ago with Coach Hewitt, that in 2 or 3 years, Vanderbilt's going to look a lot different than they are now, because she talked about not only going after great student athletes, great students academically, but she also talked about recruiting better athletes, and she will. She's got a great personality. She's a very positive coach, and she knows what she wants, and to some degree, I think she's getting it today. I mean, they're just Florida's just a better club, but I think to some degree, Vanderbilt has done fairly well under the circumstances, even though they're down 16-6.
Saw a great shot of campus here at the University of Cincinnati. What a beautiful campus this is. It's certainly an urban setting, although downtown Cincinnati is not far away, but a couple miles south of here. Another Florida draw control. The winner of Cincinnati and Temple waiting in the wings against what appears to be the Florida Gators. And if you're wondering, Florida beat Cincinnati in their last regular season game 26-5. And they beat Temple in the first conference game of the year, much lower scoring game, 15-8. Cincinnati Bearcats, they hadn't played well, obviously, in that last game. And they didn't get off to a great start, but a terrific turnaround. Cincinnati has been one of the best home teams in the country. And given the fact that it was predetermined, no matter how the seeding shook out, that the tournament would be held here in the Queen City, maybe a little bit of an advantage for UC. And we'll find out as things continue. Nobody is stopping Sydney Parekh today. She's got records on her mind.
Tremendous. Richard mentioned on the sideline the Gators 7-2 record on the road, and to me, I think that's really impressive. And the reason being is, and I don't have any research to this effect, but I have a feel for it, that in most sports for women's athletics, they have a really difficult time competing on the road, whether it's basketball or volleyball or track and field, cross country. It's just, for whatever reason, I felt over a course of a long period of time, women are just more comfortable at home. But the Gators are an exception to this rule. And Coach O'Leary has done a tremendous job. When you're 7-2 on the road, that's just fantastic for a women's program, particularly lacrosse, at this stage of the season. They're on a roll.
Now, this game is all about Sydney Pereka. She's got 5 goals and 6 assists, which means Pereka now has 201 points in her career, just the 7th Gator to hit 200 points in her collegiate career. And how about this note for a Florida team that's been offensive-minded? It's the 9th year in program history. And when they score at least 14 goals, the Gators are 126-2. And they lead 17-6 with a running clock here in the second half against the Vanderbilt Commodores.
The Gators have made a lot of improvements. I know in their lacrosse program, they have Disney Stadium now. It's a nice facility at 1,500 seats. I happen to have a nephew. He may be watching this broadcast, Dr. Galante at the University of Florida Shands Hospital. But I must admit, this is very unique for me because my son actually lives in Nashville, Tennessee. So I have dual ties to this. I'm very excited to be able to bring this here today.
Randy O'Leary looking on. Of course, there is one other connection that we haven't suggested yet, but it's a rather obvious one between these two schools. We'll let it linger for just a moment. Florida Gators trying to make waves here. And that obvious connection is that Mackenzie Mason was a defender for Florida, is the daughter of the Vanderbilt head football coach, Derek Mason. I imagine his allegiances lie with his daughter in this afternoon's contest.
Oh, no.
Although I'm not sure he would admit it or not. I don't know. I would think he's probably got family on his mind.
It's certainly nice to see that. You see that more and more often, generations of youngsters competing in athletics with their parents. Collegiately. Another good break for Florida.
Yeah, Kavanaugh with a well-caused turnover. Racing toward the cage. Good denial. Foglio with a terrific save. That's going to stay on this end of the field. That was one of her better plays of the game. It was a nice save with her left shin. In the meantime, 8-meter free position for the Florida Gators. Shot goes just a little wide right. Brianna Harris misfires, junior from Annapolis.
It's interesting too, if I'm not mistaken, both of these athletic programs have relatively new athletic directors. I know that Vandy just hired a new AD, a couple months ago? And certainly the Florida athletic director is relatively new, and I knew Jeremy Foley many years ago, who was a longtime athletic director at University of Florida, and there's really no better place to compete in the SEC than with the Gators or at Vandy. Both schools have a lot of pluses.
Malcolm Turner is the athletic director. Just hired back in early February down at Vanderbilt. Another Gator goal. Grace Haas having herself a heck of a conference semifinal as just a freshman. You think about some of the terrific young women who have played lacrosse for the University of Florida in their brief history, and Grace Haas appears to be someone who's going to have a great career down there.
Tremendous job by Haas. And then Lindsay Rombach, the 5'5 senior out of Manhasset, New York, did a great job of giving herself up. She certainly could have taken a shot there, but found Haas cutting through with the assist and the goal, and the Gators are 18-6 up on the Commodores.
Clock continuing to run. Of course, Scott Strickland, the athletic director for Florida, he's been on campus since late 2016, and the Gators are one of the premier athletic departments in the country. Looks like we got a substitution here. Paige Aldave runs off the field.
Gainesville, certainly a great place to visit, as is all these schools. Temple, Philly's a great place. Nashville. Cincinnati's wonderful.
Wonder if Nashville is still recovering from the NFL draft.
Wow, that was huge for them. That's a big statement, and it puts them in position probably when they get a new stadium to host a Super Bowl. It's a big deal.
I think there were some rave reviews about what Nashville did last week hosting the NFL draft.
And they're used to putting on major events with all the country music.
Absolutely.
So that's a good thing. And I think for lacrosse's sake, I think Nashville could be a hot spot simply because hockey is a hot spot in Nashville now. The Preds are really well received in that area. And lacrosse, I think, is comparable to some degree. And there's another score.
Bree Gross, freshman from the West Coast, puts one in. Unfortunately for Vanderbilt, still an 11-goal difference, so the clock continues to run. But it's now 18-7.
Again, you remember, Vanderbilt is a very young team, and Gross does a good job of switching hands there, firing that one with the right hand. She was moving through traffic with the left and flipped it over. Did a nice job, the young freshman, number 33.
Well, I would think that if Florida's going to win a conference championship here, I realize that so much of the offense has been impressive, but Haley Hicklin has done more than her fair share offensively.
No doubt, and they played a lot of man-to-man defense. They have not given the Commodores a lot of good looks today.
There were some fans on the Vanderbilt side that were not happy that the clock continued to run while Florida took their time coming away from scoring the goal. 18-7 Florida, midway through the second half. Let's go down to Richard Heide. Well, maybe not. I think we're having some technical difficulties. We'll try to work those through.
Maggie Corbo, number 32, in the lineup now for Florida. You see her on the right side of the screen cutting through.
And both teams at this point have an opportunity to bring a handful of additional players on. Pereca, I don't think, is going to play the rest of the game. Would be really surprised if she does. This is Hannah Martini. Rather Martinet, I beg your pardon.
Martinet has 18 points this season for the Gators, including 8 goals.
It's been tougher to get on the field behind some of the starters, but has been productive when she's in there. Free position for Florida. They lead by 11. Low shot and another goal.
Hall.
It's Maddie Hall. And it's 19-7.
She's a senior out of Sykesville, Maryland, and another Gators played really well today, mostly on the defensive end today, I think. Very good with the left hand there.
Timeout, Vanderbilt. Commodores trailing 19-7. This has not really gone the way that they had hoped, though I think they recognize that this was a tall task today. Beth Hewitt stressed how important it was to use this as a building block for her program.
I think it all started with the draw control and the ability to take advantage of that, with Kavanaugh doing a great job and then Florida really running out and clearing really well. They were very proficient in the first half, and that's been the difference. And ironically, this is like the first match of the season.
Yeah, it certainly is. You know, one of the things we talked with Beth Hewitt about this week is the winning culture that she's trying to build. And she referenced how many different coaches just within her own athletic department that she's been able to work with. And most notably pointed out Tim Corbin of their baseball program, who's had one of the best baseball programs in the country year after year. And she says that she's got some great relationships with other terrific coaches, but Tim in particular is someone that really stressed how important it is to build relationships. And she pointed out, you know, that the first hour that she was on campus, before she was a head coach, and this was, you know, several years before she took over the program as a head coach. She said she was in a CPR training on campus, and Tim Corbin not only knew her by name before he'd even met her in person, but knew about her background and made her feel so welcome. She said, you know, that just spoke volumes coming from somebody who has built such a successful program. She said it's been one of those things that has always stuck with her. You hear people talk a lot about how important relationships are, but when you have other coaches you can lean on within your own department, you might not be coaching the same sport, but the philosophy can still be there.
Yeah, I think that's important. I mentioned off the air how important it is for coaches, they want to be successful, to get input from others, to get input from their peers, because oftentimes they're so close to it, they can't see some of the things that other people can.
Vanderbilt quickly up the field. They put one in. That didn't take any time. Nice. Cassidy Orban bounces one in the bottom left side. It's 19-8.
Well, there's no doubt Vanderbilt has to play with absolute urgency. And they were able to do that time. And as you mentioned, Orban make that, number 9. Comes to the right side and fires it through a couple defenders. And Hicklin misses it, doesn't pick it up. And Vanderbilt on the board now for number 8.
A little bit of gamesmanship from the Florida Gators. The referees did not ask the clock to stop, though. Well, Vanderbilt's doing what they need.
Yep.
And that starts at the draw. Commodores have to score here quickly. Trying to get it back to 10, and then they'll need another one to stop the running clock. Good stick work inside. The flag comes out. Vanderbilt has been efficient offensively. They just haven't had nearly the same number of opportunities. Free position coming up. Vanderbilt will have Emily Mathewson take it in just a second. Referee stops things for a moment. Let's go down to Richard.
Brendan and Mike, you guys have been talking about this all day long, but just the firepower offensively from Ronbeck, Kavanaugh, House, and Pereca. Those four players have combined for 17 of the 19 goals here this evening, and over 70% of the goals all season long for this Florida team. All of them have over 30 on the season.
Yeah, it's been their balance and their power offensively, knowing that there are lots of different players that can score. Meanwhile, Vanderbilt saying, hey, hold on a second, we're not done quite yet. Mathewson not exactly smiling, but just ripped the back of the net nicely.
And Mathewson, we expected her to have more production in today's game. And a lot of the credit goes to the Gator defense, but that time she zips one by in the near post. And once again, Vanderbilt within 10. I was gonna say, Brendan, if you have 70% of your top scorers, you gotta keep them healthy. And that's knock on wood right now. Both these clubs have been fairly healthy in today's match. That's something you can't count on, but depth right now is important for Florida because now they have some youngsters out there just in case something happens, which you never hope that it does.
Well, apparently Florida's Alex Lopez had a false start on that draw control. And so with 8 minutes to go, Vanderbilt has it back, and a goal here would take the running clock out of play. Still got a long way to go. Fornia. And Vanderbilt turns it over. Well, the rhythm of this second half's been a little odd on both ends, to be honest with you.
Mm-hmm.
Florida still in a position here where they probably want to play keep away. Vanderbilt has to attack the ball. problem is, because you're down double digits, even on a foul like that, that stops play but doesn't stop the clock.
And it's running. Take a look at it. 7:05 and counting. Technically, the official scoreboard now is at 7:05.
An empty stick check, and it goes back the other way. One of the Gators is being told to come back behind the ball. Vanderbilt not wasting any time, but trying to find open pockets of space. Ellie Reagan. Near side now, Mathewson. Denied by Annie Gillis. And a whistle comes from behind the plate. Gators lead by 10, Commodores with the ball. Good pass inside, and the flag's out on the hit to the head.
Mentioned Annie Gillis a minute ago. She's a freshman, so another youngster from Florida on a team that has a lot of upperclassmen that has excelled in this match today.
Oh, beautiful job on the free position, but did everything right except for finish.
And Julie Blaze there coming across.
Hicklin's way out of the circle, tries to win it back and does. Haley Hicklin has had a terrific game. Goalkeeper of the year in the conference this season. And truly the backbone of this Florida team. She doesn't really score all the goals that we've mentioned so often from Pereca and Rhinebeck and the like. But if you don't have the ability to rely on a good goaltender, doesn't matter how often you score, you gotta be able to know you can get stops. And Hicklin has looked really good.
That's a plus. And, you know, one of the things I noted in the previous possession was Hicklin communicating through her mask. So goalies also have to be good communicators. They're like field generals out there positioning her team. And that's another positive thing I'm sure that she's got and brings to the table for the Gators.
Waning minutes of Vanderbilt's season. Trying to piece something together here late, but they need the ball back first. Meanwhile, Grace Haas, just a freshman. She's got 5 goals. That's a career high for her. We've already touched on the fact that Pereca has a career high 6 assists and a career high 11 points in this game. She scored 5 goals on just 7 shots. Timeout Florida. Andy O'Leary is unhappy. She comes out onto the field. 4 minutes exactly left in regulation. 14 seconds on the shot clock whenever Florida comes out of their timeout, but Coach O'Leary is not thrilled. Get a look there at her assistant coaches as well. Nadine Hadnagy and Taryn Venthoff done such a great job down in Florida. When you think about the success they've had in the 9th year of their program history.
Good coaching is good teaching, and you've got to take times during competition to teach your team as much as you possibly can so that they can get better. That's the only way teams improve, and frankly, even though they're 5-0, the Gators are 5-0 in conference play, and it appears that they're going to win this semifinal, you still have to teach. There is a lot of lacrosse ahead of them. They've got a championship match on Saturday, and chances are they're going to compete in the NCAA tournament, and teaching is vital. If you can't teach, you can't coach.
National tournament will find out its field Sunday evening at 8 o'clock. The selection show will post. I believe that's on NCAA.com. Of course, the Gators hoping that they won't have to sweat it out. They're hoping that they'll know they're in by virtue of the automatic berth for the tournament champions, but Cincinnati and Temple want to have something to say about it.
Coach O'Leary is a 88 Temple grad. There's a lot of Philly flavor in this field here. I know Coach Carter with UC, she's a Philly girl as well.
And oh, by the way, the Cincinnati coaching staff might have the highest of accolades of anybody. What Gina's done in her playing career is just remarkable, having won at the highest level in the World Cup. She was an All-American at Ohio State in her playing days, then Gina Oliver. But coach has just been so impressive at the University of Cincinnati and is helping this this program here at UC to new heights. We'll talk about them quite a bit in our upcoming telecast. In the meantime, final minutes of this game in front of us. Vanderbilt trying to take the running clock out of effect with the goal there, but the shot goes too tall. Pass back to Fournier. Gabby trying to do it all herself, checked away. Shoots across her body on one hop, and it's saved by Kensley Cattell, the junior who has come into goal. I think she came in right at that timeout. Play the last minute and a half. And we'll play the remaining 2 minutes and change.
That's Alonzo, 26. Again, and she's a senior, doesn't get much playing time, 5'4 attacker out of Massapequa, New York.
Obviously, tournament time brings out lots of emotions on both sides of the equation. Oh, clock is going to stop here, and a green card comes out. It's on Melanie Becker, so she heads off. Only 1:41 remaining. Anyways, obviously when you are on the right side of things, tournament time's a lot of fun, a lot of joy, but it's always difficult to lose. And in most cases, when you lose in your conference tournament, it's the end of the season.
Mm-hmm.
You see Eddie Shoup run behind the cage there.
If you're a senior and you don't have plans to play at the next level, this is it.
A reminder that Cincinnati and Temple game will begin roughly 45 minutes after this one wraps up. It'll be right here on the American Digital Network. Andy O'Leary.
That's why she's a great coach. She's still teaching on the sideline and pushing those youngsters to play harder.
Ninth year in the program, she's about to pick up her 322nd win. Outstanding.
They're about first. Program started, can you believe that, 10 years ago, and it's their third league championship.
Unbelievable.
Third league championship.
Well, they've won the conference championship in the regular season every single year. About 20 seconds left, and Vanderbilt scores again. So the running clock stops on Emily Mathewson's rocket. Unfortunately for the Commodores, too little, too late.
Good job by Mathewson over the right shoulder of the goalkeeper there.
And again for Vanderbilt, seniors Alex Rasmussen, Hadley Brown, Melanie Becker, redshirt senior Lexi Smith, Grace Bell, Julie Blaze. This is it. Commodores probably going to be on the outside looking in that selection show for an at-large berth, given that they finished the regular conference season at 2-3, although their overall record at 10-5 wasn't too shabby. Got off to a 5-0 start, but a disappointing end of the season for Vanderbilt. This day belonged to Sydney Pereca and the Florida Gators. Florida passes a couple of times middle of the field to run out the clock, and the game is over. The Florida Gators on their way to a conference championship appearance on Saturday with a 19-10 win in the semifinals over Vanderbilt.
Great effort by the Gators. Good job by Coach O'Leary getting her team in a position to win this game today. They played extremely well on both ends.
Sydney Pereca will be the most outstanding player in this game. 5 goals, 6 assists. Grace Haas had 5 goals of her own, 4 for Kavanaugh, all in the first half, by the way. Ronbeck, 5 points. She had 3 goals and a couple of assists. Just a terrific effort. We'll take a quick timeout, and we'll come back to check in with both Sydney Pereca and with Coach O'Leary. So we'll come right back to Cincinnati after this. 19-10, the final score. The Gators moving on to the championship game.
Bernie scores!
3 strikeouts in a row.
Dominance for a 4th straight year.
Queso from 30.
Unbelievable.
And be able to celebrate the 7th championship.
There's the record breaker. They are the champions of the American.
A good sportsmanship on both sides between Florida and Vanderbilt in the semifinal. Florida Gators, 10th win in a row, Mike. Isn't this certainly the way you want to go about it? You got to get hot at the right time and peak at the end of the season, and the Gators have done just that.
They're doing that, and they had an opportunity today to play their young people in the second half, which is very important to be able to get match experience for the young kids on the squad.
Down on the field with head coach and winning head coach, Mandy O'Leary. Let's go down to Richard.
Coach O'Leary, congratulations. Quite a performance. How's it feel to now reach the inaugural conference finals?
Oh, it's exciting. I mean, I thought our team played really hard, but credit Vanderbilt. I mean, they came out here with a great game plan. We just played very, very well today.
Your team, number 10 in terms of the RPI, you're ranked all season, but you're 7-2 on the road. How do you stay grounded traveling away from Florida and being able to play in an environment like this?
Well, I mean, I think for us, it's just another game. Our success on the road, I think, is indicative of the work that they put in prior to getting here. This is a business trip for us, and we treat it as such. So it's kind of how we do it.
You beat Cincinnati 25-6. I'm sure you're going to stay and watch this game next. But if it is Cincinnati, what type of challenge do they present?
I mean, any team we play, whether it's Cincinnati or Temple, I mean, they're great, great competition. We had a good first half with Temple. I mean, it was a solid, solid game. And the same with Cincinnati. We had them at our place, which obviously poses a huge advantage for us. So either of those teams, we're going to be focused on us, but we know that it's going to be a battle out there. It's going to be a great game no matter who we play.
Head Coach Mandy O'Leary, thanks so much. Congratulations. And we are ready for Sydney Pereca. And it looks like she's coming over here right now. Sydney Pereca, 5 goals, 6 assists. What a performance. Just an incredible game out there. How did it feel?
It felt awesome. I mean, it was totally a team win. I wouldn't be able to do anything I did today without the help of my teammates and them finishing the ball when we needed to.
You seem like you really brought a lot of energy out there, and you sort of facilitated the entire offense. How does it feel kind of be the centerpiece and being able to distribute to your teammates like that?
Yeah, I mean, I'm a senior, so this is my 4th year doing this, and I know that I kind of hold a leadership role. So if I need to take over and help my team and conduct the offense or the defense, then I can do that for my team.
So now you get the next step, which is the inaugural trip to the conference championship and then the NCAAs. What are the team goals and your personal goals from here on out throughout the rest of the season?
I mean, I think it's clear that our team goal is to obviously win our conference and the tournament. And personally, for me, it's just helping out my teammates in the best way that I can and just getting the team win.
Sydney Pereca, what a game. Thanks so much. Congratulations.
Sydney Pereca, easily the most outstanding player on the field, with the career-high 6 assists and the career-high 11 points. What a performance in her senior year, trying to go out on top. So Florida wins 19-10 over Vanderbilt, and they wait the winner of game two. Cincinnati and Temple coming up in just about 45 minutes. We'll have that one for you live on the American Digital Network. Awfully fun afternoon in game one, but game two will hopefully be just as fun here coming up. For Mike Walensky and for Rich Heide, I'm Brendan Gulick. 19-10, the Florida Gators championship bound on Saturday afternoon. Come on back for Temple and Cincinnati coming up in about an hour here on the American Digital Network.